Thank you, Dr. Scott Regenbogen, for talking to the Op Report today about the changing management for elective surgery for diverticulitis.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity.
So the risk of future episodes after the first episode of diverticulitis was sort of, we believed, was the reason to operate on these patients. Can you talk about the risk of future episodes after a first episode of diverticulitis?
Sure. I think the good old days, the textbooks would say if you had two episodes in your life, or you had one episode before you turned 50, that you had a more virulent form of the disease that would require an operation. To some extent, this was anecdotal and not evidence-based. And when you really look at the risk of future episodes after a single episode of uncomplicated diverticulitis, it turned out to be really, really relatively low. So somewhere between 20 and 40% of patients would go on to have another episode of diverticulitis. Age slightly increased that risk, but not substantially. And what you really saw was that patients who had simple diverticulitis managed with antibiotics, their future episodes tended to mimic their first. And so if you really ask patients, this episode you just have, if you have a 1 in 3 chance of having another one like it, does that justify a colectomy and the attendant risks? It turned out not to really justify the operation. It turned out that the risk of anastomotic leak from a colorectal anastomosis after sigmoid colectomy for diverticulitis wasn't that much lower than the risk of complicated diverticulitis in patients who had a single episode of simple diverticulitis. So after a single episode of simple diverticulitis, the risk of a future complicated episode, abscess, fistula, stricture, acute perforation requiring emergency operation, turned out to be less than 5%. So I think all the reasons that we used to scare patients into operations, basically we would tell them, let me do it electively so you know, I don't have to give you a bag, turned out to be a little misleading.
Yeah. So what are the indications now for an elective resection?
I think that it really has to be individualized. So again, it gets a little bit hard because we don't have a real hard and fast algorithmic way to identify the right patients for operations. But what I tell patients who come to me, and most of them come to me from a referring doctor who's told them, all right, you've hit the 3-episode threshold or the 4-episode threshold, you need an operation. What I tell them is, think about the episodes you've had. Think about how frequent they've been, how much they've affected your life, to what extent they've interfered with your day-to-day health. Ask yourself what your symptoms are like on a daily basis if you have a more smoldering or chronic version of the disease, and ask whether that justifies the operation. And then I tell them about the operation, the risks, and the recovery. The other thing I tell them is that there's no guarantee that the operation will eliminate the syndrome that they're experiencing. So it turns out that about 15 to 20% of patients who have elective surgery for recurrent diverticulitis find that they still have the same symptoms that they had attributed to their diverticulitis in the past. Mm. Whether that's because they have irritable bowel syndrome, or whether that's because they have something wrong with their colon that gives them symptoms, or you know, something we can't explain. So what I really have to explain to patients is the relative benefits and the relative risks, and let them make individual decisions.
Okay. And what is your choice of operation for the typical patient with recurrent sigmoid diverticulitis that he's having a lot of hospitalizations, a lot of ongoing pain?
My preferred operation is a laparoscopic sigmoid colectomy with a colorectal anastomosis, and under certain circumstances, a diverting loop ileostomy if I feel like the risk of anastomotic leak is higher than I'm willing to accept. Many of those patients, I will choose to place a left ureteral stent if, when I look at the CT scan, that left ureter looks like it may be involved in a dense inflammatory process. The actual conduct of the operation, it's extremely important to remove the distal sigmoid. It turns out that the number one predictor of recurrent diverticulitis after elective surgery for diverticulitis is the conduct of a colocolonic versus a colorectal anastomosis. So very important that the anastomosis be made to the upper rectum. On the proximal side, very important to remove all of the chronically inflamed fibrotic colon. You don't have to remove every diverticulum. You know, I'd end up doing total colectomies if we did. It's okay to leave a diverticula in the patient as long as you're making an anastomosis with soft, supple, otherwise healthy intestine.
And what are the circumstances in which you will give them a diverting ileostomy?
Oh, this is a real how am I feeling about the anastomosis kind of decision. So the hard indications in my mind are people who've had radiation, who have radiation proctitis, people in whom I make an anastomosis below the peritoneal reflection, which would certainly be uncommon in these patients, and then anyone where the anastomosis just doesn't go well. So imagine we make our colorectal anastomosis and I air leak test it and it leaks. My preference there is to take down the anastomosis and redo it, but let's imagine I'm running out of choices and I still have an anastomosis that has air bubbles.
Right.
That would be a time to make a diverting leak ileostomy.
Right. Okay. Now, just some questions about perioperative management and your use of preps and the fast track, and curious how length of stay has changed with new management styles.
Yeah. Our normal preoperative preparation is simply a Fleet's enema. We do not routinely give oral mechanical bowel preparation, except in patients where I am absolutely planning a diverting loop ileostomy. I like to then not have a column of stool between the ileostomy and the anus, but otherwise no oral mechanical bowel preps. The patients are allowed to eat up until midnight and to have clear liquids up until 2 hours before their operation, so they don't come in dehydrated and they don't come in hypoglycemic. In the operating room, we try to essentially maintain physiologic sort of normality. So we ask the anesthesiologists to keep them isovolemic, not flood them with fluid. We ask the anesthesiologists not to use long-acting sedatives. We try to maximize the use of adjuncts that will reduce the use of narcotics. So we use epidurals for big laparotomies. We use transversus abdominis plane blocks that I do laparoscopically for smaller operations, operations with smaller incisions. And then after the operations, we use lots of non-narcotic medications. So we use standing Tylenol, standing intravenous non-steroidals in patients who don't have contraindications. And then we use narcotics sparingly. And if you do all of these things and you allow patients to advance their diet as they'll tolerate, you mobilize them and you take out their catheters and you don't place in nasogastric tubes, patients who have uncomplicated hospital courses will frequently be able to go home on the postoperative day 2, 3, or 4.
Wow.
So I would say our median patient who doesn't have complicating factors, who is otherwise fairly fit, who doesn't have an operative complication, who is capable of limiting their use of narcotics, will go home in 3 or 4 days.
That's great. That's a great advancement since the ones I remember from my early training in the
90s. Absolutely.
Great. Anything else about elective management of diverticulitis?
I think for me the biggest challenge is simply communicating to patients information that they often have never heard before. They really have showed up in my office expecting that I'm going to book an operation, and it becomes a conversation. And almost every patient leaves the office without a decision and calls me back. So for me, I think it really is all about individualizing the patients and trying to decide whether their current syndrome, not their fear of a bag or their fear of a blowout complication in the future, they really have to ask themselves whether their current syndrome justifies an operation. And that's what really drives me. The other thing that I think about is making sure that I have the diagnosis right. So it turns out that there is no evidence that patients with simple diverticulitis who get better after an episode of diverticulitis have a higher incidence of neoplasia. And this is one point where I'm willing to ignore the data. To me, any patient who has a CAT scan that looks like diverticulitis, I feel like it's imperative to prove that it is not one of the other things that mimic it. And those three things are Crohn's disease, ischemic colitis, and malignancy. You can rule out Crohn's disease and ischemic colitis pretty well based on history, but I feel like endoscopic confirmation to rule out malignancy is mandatory in most circumstances.
Very good, very good. Well, thanks a lot for taking some time away from the American College meeting. That's where you are, right?
That's right, that's right.
Well, go enjoy it, and thanks a lot for talking.
Thanks so much.
Thanks for checking out the Op Report. Help us keep conversations alive on topics in general surgery. Check out more episodes of the Op Report and other OnSurg content here at YouTube. Find us at Facebook. Follow us on Twitter. And find our homepage at OnSurg.com. Join the conversation and tell us what topics you'd like to hear about and what people you'd like to hear from.